Hi, this is Laura Pepperwoo with 30 Day Books, and today we're talking with Tarryn Fisher, author of The Opportunist. And The Opportunist was published back in
November 2011,
and recently got into the top 100 in literary fiction on Amazon.com. So, hi Tarryn, how are you doing today?
I'm good, Laura, thank you. How are you?
Great. And you're in Florida today.
Yes, I am.
Okay, so why don't you tell us a bit about The Opportunist, which is your debut novel, I believe?
Yes. The Opportunist is kind of a non-conventional story about a girl that gets a second chance with the ex-love of her life. She takes some really risky, makes some really risky moves. And the remarkable thing about the book is that it had a great emotional response on the readers. I know when I was writing it, I was sitting at my kitchen table crying, sobbing my eyes out for most of it. I poured myself into it, and the readers had the same response. I never expected that.
Okay, that's a great analysis. So how did you conjure up those emotional responses? Like, are these taken from experiences in your past, or did you have some inspiration? Like, what was it that enabled you to write such a powerful book?
Well, first, I was very bored with a lot of the protagonists I was reading about. So I went to the great ones, my favorites, Scarlett O'Hara, Lisbeth Salander from The Dragon and Tattoo. And I decided that I wanted a character like this. And who better to pull that from than myself? I used myself, yes, I used my own thoughts. I based all of my characters' decisions on the things that I could do or that I would do. So basically, I'm admitting I'm a very bad person. But yes, I took from my life, definitely. I decided I wanted to do something bold and honest. I wanted to be really honest.
Okay. So you self-published the book, but what was your journey like before you made that decision? What was your publishing journey like?
Well, after I completed the book, I went the traditional route. I took it to the publishing houses. I got the same response from most of them. They said, chick lit is dead. Even if it were not dead, you don't really fit into that genre. Mm-hmm. So you would have to clean up this novel, change Olivia. You'd have to soften her up, change your story. It's too angsty. And I got that from everyone. Maybe five different houses told me that same thing. So I had to make the decision whether I wanted to conform or stick to my guns. And I believed in what I wrote, so I said, no, I'm not going to change her, and I walked away. If anything, I made her worse. I'm rebellious, so I just decided to plug even more evil into Olivia. And what I did was I started my website, and I would post a chapter a week. And I marketed and I advertised that I was doing this. And readers would come on and give me a lot of response to what was going on. And I listened. If they said I didn't do enough of this, I would fix it. If I didn't show enough of that, I would fix it. After that happened, I decided to go indie, probably because of how well some of the other indie authors were doing. Mm-hmm. And I figured if you work hard and if you tell the truth, you can make it in this business. And like I said, I'm a rebel. And they told me no. And I was like, yes, I will do this. I will do this without you.
Nice. So it was a kind of crowdsourced writing. You were getting feedback as you were going along.
Yes.
Yeah. And how were you finding these people? Are these people you knew within your immediate circle? Or did you find that you were getting readers from outside of that?
I got readers from outside. It started in my circle, but what I did was I made up hundreds of postcards. I made up car magnets, and they said, you know, read a book for free online. We need your input. And I sent those out, and I got a lot of feedback from that. I had 10,000 reads on the book when I posted it in chapters online.
Wow.
Just from that.
And this was on your own website? You weren't
this
using
was on my website.
A third party? Okay. So those readers, did you ever, you know, keep in touch with them? Did you get their email addresses or anything like that? Or have you kept in touch with them since then?
Yes, most of them I have on my Facebook. Absolutely. We would email back and forth. I found the really valuable readers had the most to say. And when you find a good reader to read your work, they give you the best feedback, honest, and they tell you what they want from the story. And I think it's so smart to listen to that.
Yeah. Well, that's fantastic. So part of the reason that I'm doing this series, you know, indie authors who are doing it right, which I believe you are, is to kind of break down this stigma that self-published authors feel. Do you think there is still a stigma towards self-published authors? And do you think your readers know that you're indie, and do you think that they care?
There is absolutely a stigma. They do not like us. They will tell you that you will not succeed. You'll destroy your career even before you've started it if you go that route. I believe that the publishing houses are kind of scared of the indie authors, because there's a rising movement of women that are standing up and saying, I will show you that people will like my story. And they're fighting through all of the stigma that's been placed on them. Readers want a good story. They want something that they can plug into and enjoy. And I don't think that if you're an indie author or if you're a traditional author, it makes a difference to them. As long as you're telling a good story, they're going to read your book.
Yeah.
And that's what's happening now with a lot of the self-published authors.
Yeah. So do you think that your readers know that you're self-published, or do you think that it's just irrelevant to them?
They do know. That's what I noticed, is there is a small pocket online right now of readers that really enjoy indie authors. They're finding something very raw in the writing. It's not as clean or as edited. It's raw emotion coming through the writers, and they are eating it up. They love it. And they know, yeah, there's a big indie author following out there, especially on Goodreads.
So it's actually, it could be seen as a positive thing almost, that you are self-published. You know, people are seeking you out for that reason.
Yes, absolutely.
Yeah. Okay, and you know, I follow you on Facebook with Facebook friends, and I've seen your love for Goodreads over the last few weeks. So do you want to sort of explain to people who are watching who might not know the beauty of Goodreads and the advantages of being on Goodreads, what is it about the community that you have found is really special, and what tools are you utilizing on Goodreads to help with your book marketing?
I'm fairly new to Goodreads. I only put The Opportunist up about 4 months ago. Mm-hmm. I really started working with it. But what I saw was a Facebook for people that love to read.
Mm-hmm.
You're complete strangers, and you're bonding over talking about books. And everyone is just so warm and inviting there. They just want to talk to you. They're eager to find new things to read. So when I put the book up there, I didn't have much hope for it. I didn't think anything would come of Goodreads. And boy, did it. I can solely credit everything that's happened with The Opportunist to the readers on Goodreads.
Okay. So how specifically were you getting the word out about the book? Were you joining forum threads or making friends with people? What was your strategy?
I wasn't. I think I got lucky. I got lucky on Goodreads because it was just a couple people that found me on there, mm-hmm. read the book, and then started telling others about it. And then I started showing up in the forums. It just kind of spread out, and people started talking about it everywhere. So I really just got lucky with that. It was nothing that I did on Goodreads.
Yeah. And I think that's the really interesting thing about your book. I mean, it is a fantastically written book, and it's very emotional and powerful. And for those reasons, it seems that word of mouth has been, you know, the most powerful form of marketing for you. And obviously, that's not something that we can control. We can't make people talk about our books. But do you want to just explain a little bit about something that happened on a blog a couple of weeks back, and just the power of word of mouth marketing and what that did for you?
Well, one reader told another reader on Goodreads about the book, and she read it, and she happened to be part of a blog online, and she told the owner of the blog about The Opportunist. Well, the owner was really passionate about the book. It affected her emotionally, And she started exploding all over her Facebook page and website as she was reading. And it piqued everyone's curiosity. So all of her followers and her readers started buying the book and reading it. And it just created this domino effect. And she set up a forum on her blog where you could come and hash out your feelings about The Opportunist. And they went, and I haven't gone in there to look because I'm afraid of what they're saying. But they apparently go in there and they talk about their feelings and how angry, you know, my characters made them. Or so that was just pure luck that one person told another person, and it just created this large audience.
Yeah. And you really couldn't ask for more as an author, right? That people are so passionate that they want to discuss your book on a forum. I mean, you must be so proud.
It's scary because, like I said, I plug myself into this book. So sometimes it feels like they might be saying something about you.
Right. You can take it personally somehow.
Yes. Yeah, definitely. I know the opinions about Olivia vary, but most people are very angry with her, so it kind of feels like they're angry with me.
That's funny. So, you know, I've seen people asking and dying to know on your Facebook and on Goodreads, when is the next book coming out, and what are your long-term goals for this? Are you hoping to make a career out of being an indie author?
I would used to say that I'm doing this to eventually get picked up by a publishing house, but I don't believe that anymore. Mm-hmm. I like this little rebellion that's happening with the indie authors, and I like being a part of it, and I think I jumped on right as it was really starting to get feet. My long-term goals, well, I'm writing the sequel mm-hmm. to The Opportunist right now, but I'm also working on a YA project that I've been very secretive about, and I just want a bigger audience. Yeah. I want my audience to grow.
Okay. And do you have a particular plan in mind for how you're going to grow your audience? Or are you just hoping that this word of mouth is going to continue to kick in and happen organically?
Word of mouth? Mm-hmm. I think it will. I think I get lucky, so I think that's what's happening. If you can build a big enough audience with your debut novel, your first book, it'll carry over to the next one and it'll keep growing. So, I mean, I have marketing techniques that I use and things that I do. Mm-hmm. But like I said, the strongest form of marketing are the readers, telling other readers to read your book.
Yeah, yeah. So the reviews on your Amazon page are very positive. You've had some wonderful, just really well-written reviews. I think people don't just say what a great book it is, they really go into details, and there are actually a lot of spoilers on the Amazon page, so for anyone who wants to go ahead and read The Opportunist, you might want to be careful about those things. But you have had a couple of negative reviews, as any author, you know, that's almost the sign of a good book, if there's a divide in opinion. But how do you deal with negative reviews, and what would your advice to others be? When they experience their first negative review, what can you do to handle it?
Well, you cry.
Okay. And then you get a glass of wine.
You cry and you get a glass of wine. You feel really sorry for yourself. And then you just go back and you read the good reviews. Okay. And you believe in what you've done. If you're eliciting an emotional response, whether it's good or bad, you're doing something right. I think the thing I fear most are people saying the writing is bad.
Right.
And no one has said that.
Yeah.
Even the bad reviews will say, the writing was good, but I hated this or I hated that. Most of the time it's character hate.
Yeah.
So.
Okay, that's a great answer. Okay, so the only other thing I wanted to ask you about, and it's kind of technical, is about your price point. So, you know, there's this huge debate always going on within the indie community. Should it be $2.99? Should it be 99 cents? Should I put it free? Should I put it on KDP Select and all these kind of things? And interestingly, you actually sort of ignored all of that advice and went for $4.99 price point, and then Amazon brought you down to $3.99. Do you want to talk a little bit about that and why you decided on that number?
Well, I'm not a big researcher, so I never actually went and saw what everyone else was doing. Mm-hmm. I wanted to make it accessible to everyone so that my audience would be larger. And when you're an indie author, there's that question, if I buy this book, is it going to be terrible? Am I going to hate it? You know, the reader wants to put out minimal amount of money when they're taking a risk on you for the first time. So that's why I priced it low. And I think it's very personal because I put in 5 years of work, 5 years of edits, 5 years of character development. And that's what I felt my book was worth. That's what I put it out there for.
Yeah. And it seems to be working for you. So that's great. All right. I don't think I have any more questions for you. I'm really looking forward to book two, which is coming out this year or early next year.
I slated it to be released in April of next year. Okay. But I will, that was playing it safe. I'll have it out a lot sooner than that. Okay.
And maybe you can get a short story out in the meantime to tie everyone over until it's released.
And my children won't allow that.
Yeah, that's something important to know. Actually, you do have two small children. How old are they now?
3 and 1.5.
3 and 1.5.
And they don't like it when I write.
So how do you find the hours in the day? What's your writing procedure like?
I don't sleep. I require very little sleep. No, really, I sleep maybe 4 hours a night.
Okay.
And that's all I need. And I write into the early hours of the morning, really. So that's what I do.
Okay. Well, I definitely don't think that's going to work for me because I need my sleep, but that's good to know. I don't have children yet, so, you know, we'll cross that bridge when we come to it. All right, thanks so much for the interview, and so exciting watching your book just take off, and I know you're going to go really far, so I'm really excited to watch you get there. So thanks so much.
Thank you, Laura.
All right, take care.